Today we're going to be talking about a very common misconception in the snow sliding world, the difference between snow blades and ski boards. What's going on, everyone? Back with another episode of Stuff and Things. Today we're talking nothing but ski boarding. I'm going to tell you a little bit of a history of the sport. And for those of you out there who mistake ski boarding for snow blades or ski blades, I'm going to tell you why you're wrong. Now, a lot of this history lesson can actually be summed up in a simple clip put out by LJ from the Traveling Circus. So let's roll that really quick.
Ski blading is an incorrect pronunciation of ski boarding. Jason Leventhal invented ski boards in 1995 in his parents' garage. Solomon came along and invented snow blades, which was their ripoff. And then a bunch of idiots, all you dumb people, started mixing the two up and calling them ski blades to make fun of them.
Oh my, yeah!
Well, joke's on you, because you're not on YouTube.
So that's a really brief overview of the sport of ski boarding and how it came about, but let's dig into that a little bit more. Freestyle skiing, sliding rails, hitting jumps, half pipes, kickers, all of that stuff that you see in the X Games now actually stemmed from the sport of ski boarding. Now, before symmetrical twin tips were a thing, like these massive things right here, which of course is super popular in today's world, in the X Games as I'm filming this right now. Before twin tip skis like that were a thing, ski boarding was the ruler of this realm. Now, back in the late 90s, early 2000s, from about 1998 up until 2000, ski boarding was a circuit in the X Games. There were people actively competing in the Winter X Games in the slope style event like Neil Lyons and Mike Nick. I actually have a super old pair of his pro model boards right here. These were my first real pair of ski boards, and I've had these for quite a long time now. These are the boards that I actually rode at the World Cup back in the later 2000s, after ski boarding was sort of already being replaced by twin tip skis. And these things have served me very well. They're actually manufactured by Line. For those of you who do ski, you already know this, but Line is a manufacturer of regular twin tip skis today. So as this sport of freestyle skiing or ski boarding started to come about, people were sliding rails, hitting big jumps, riding in massive half pipes, and doing flips and all sorts of tricks. As they came about, there were manufacturers like Line who started producing really high quality ski boards like this right here. I could still ride these today, and they have been beat to hell. With a good product like this, they will last you a very long time. So you had companies like Line and Canon making all sorts of really high quality ski boards. And it actually started back even before that with the Bigfoot. And these are technically ski boards, but kind of frowned upon in the community. I mean, I guess they're cool, but they're not a traditional ski board. So as this ski boarding circuit was gaining popularity, there was another company who came out and created these abominations, the Solomon Snowblades. Now, this is not a very good direct comparison because these are super short. These are probably about 75 centimeters. So Solomon started mass producing these crappy mini skis here. And because they were making so many of them, these became cheaper than actual ski boards like this. And then these sort of took over with the whole, I don't want to call them gapers. It's not a gaper community, but it's like the casual skier community. People who go out and ride maybe once or twice a year, they're not really into freestyle or hardcore skiing. So they found these because they're fun, and they are. However, snowblades and ski boards have a lot of very important differences. So with a high quality ski board back from the late 90s, you can expect something like this. It's a symmetrical design with a four hole construction right in the middle. So there are inserts down into a wood core, and then it's got typical bases and edges like you would find on a modern ski today. These happen to be a cap construction on the sidewall. And as you can see, over the years of me banging these things together, they're still holding up pretty damn well. Now, the four holes to mount up a binding is very important because it allows the board to actually flex under your foot. Now, that will make a lot more sense when we compare it to a snowblade. So what makes a ski board superior to a snowblade? Now, like I said, these were mass produced and probably still produced by Solomon today. They are typically on the shorter end. They range from maybe 75 up to 100-ish in centimeters. What's bad about the construction of these is it is typically a foam core, and it has these plastic bindings on here that are mounted up in an 8-hole pattern. The way you adjust these bindings is you like slip this plastic piece out here, you move this around, pop it back into place, and then slide that clip down. So they're pretty easy to adjust, but the problem with this, like I mentioned, is it's foam core. You have 8 holes into that foam core. The plastic binding is mounted directly to the top sheet of this snow blade, so it doesn't really allow any flex or anything like that. When you compare it to a pro model ski board like this, these aren't super flexy either, but these are made to be a little bit stiffer for riding in the park. Now, the tiny little snow blades are not gonna flex at all because obviously they are almost too small to flex, but imagine this being a little bit longer. From the front mounting point of the binding here to the rear mounting point of the binding, when all of this is screwed down to the top sheet of the snow blade, it's not going to be able to flex in between those two points. It's super easy to rip the binding inserts out of that foam core, and it's just junk. So if you're looking for ski boards, you typically want to look for something with a 4-hole construction like this right here. And let's actually take a look at my personal ski boards and some other options that are out there right now. So moving into the era of a traditional ski board, right here you will see that we still have a symmetrical design, twin tips on both the front and the rear. This allows you to ride forward and backward pretty much the same. We still have a 4-hole construction here, and this is a non-release binding. Underneath that non-release binding, you have a rubber pad which allows the board to flex. So with a boot mounted to the non-release binding, you have mounting points to the actual board right here. So pretty much everywhere from these two points, it will allow these tips to flex in both directions. Now these are the Revel 8 Revolts. It's a Stuff and Things collab, almost like my pro model board. And these come with a wood core, just like the Mike Nick Pros did back in the late 90s. Now the construction of these are a little bit different because you actually have a sidewall here as opposed to the cap construction on the Mike Nick Pros. Some people like this, some people like the cap construction because it may be a little bit more durable if you're smacking your skis together. I don't really care either way. As long as it's a 4-hole construction, solid wood core board, then pretty good in my book. So this, as of right now, is a pretty standard ski board setup with a non-release binding. Let me actually show you how you can mount a boot to this. You do use traditional ski boots. I typically am riding some Full Tilt Classics. You put the boot on the binding just like that. You're gonna flip up the heel bail, slide your foot back, and then pick up the toe bail. And I have my binding set super tight because I'm riding in the park all the time. So I really need to crank down on this toe bail. And there you have it. I prefer non-release bindings because I do ride in the park. You're gonna get the most control out of a board with a setup like this. There are also some other options like non-release bindings, which you would mount to a 4-hole construction using a riser. That may be good for people who are afraid of any kind of leg injury. If you want the boards to come off in the event of a crash, then that would definitely be a better option for you. Now, the reason I don't ride release bindings with risers is because I want to be closer to the board. That gives me better edge control on rails. That way you can sort of gas pedal and spin in either direction. We're getting into the technical stuff now, but when I fall, I don't want these things to come shooting off. With a riser and a non-release binding, you're gonna be sitting way higher off the board, so it's gonna give you a little bit more leverage to get the board over on edge, but it adds to the overall weight of a setup like this, and this is just OG, original, classic, and that's why I love non-release bindings still. There is one other option that I haven't ridden, but Revel 8 actually makes some adapters to mount snowboard bindings to a ski board. That way you can actually wear snowboard boots and just sort of ratchet in just like you were riding a snowboard. Now the reason I don't prefer those is because typically they're gonna be a little bit flexier than a ski boot, and I need the rigidity in my ankles to be able to jump and flip and slide rails and everything like that. But if ski boots are really not your thing, then you could also opt for a soft boot setup like that if you were interested. So again, ski boards, typically wider, wood core construction, really high quality, 4-hole insert to mount bindings to. And you have snow blades or ski blades, whatever people call these nowadays. Typically a lower quality construction. You got that foam core, typically also about the width of a ski, traditional ski. My personal boards are really not that wide, and you can see the difference right here. You get an extra almost inch. And then if we look at it tail to tail, you're gonna be getting way more surface area with these, allowing you to ride in powder and pretty much any condition out there. So speaking of riding in a bunch of different conditions, let's take a look at some other ski board models that are available right now for different riding conditions. A lot of people see ski boards and they don't really understand the purpose of them. What are they good for? What can you do with them? I can confidently say that I can do anything on ski boards that any skier or snowboarder can do. I've got a quiver of ski boards behind me, so let me run you through some other models that are out there. Up first right here, I have the Revel 8 KTPs or the Kirk Thompson Pros. This used to be my go-to board because they are so versatile. They're nice and stiff for riding in the park, but they still have a little bit of flexibility to them. These are super wide. We'll do another comparison of a snowblade to a ski board right here. That's the nose, and that's the tail. These things are basically designed like a snowboard with that high quality construction, being symmetrical and being super wide. Now, what's also great about the KTPs is that you have the four hole construction, but you also have two more holes in the rear. That way you can actually set back your entire binding if you know you're gonna be riding in powder. So since these boards are symmetrical, typically I would mount my binding right in the middle, putting my boot at about this area right here. But if I slide that binding back and use the rear holes to mount, you will see that it gives me a lot more nose, which will allow you to float over powder a lot easier. So just like my model, this is another really great model to do all sorts of mountain riding. Now, speaking of riding in the powder, if you want something a little bit longer and with even more float to it, right here I have a Revel 8 Condor. Let's do another comparison next to a snowblade. Snowblade versus ski board. This is the nose of the snowblade next to the ski board. I have about a hand width of extra width on there. Again, these are symmetrical, so look how much extra width you have on the tail. This will allow you to sit back, float through powder. These tips will remain up in the air. And this, on a pow day, especially if you're riding like backcountry or something like that, these are amazing. So my models are about 105s. The Condors are coming in at 110. So this is gonna be one of the longest ski boards made by Revel 8 right now. So if you think that these things would be floaty in powder, let me show you the last pair. Here we have the Revel 8 Rockered Condors. Now, if you know anything about ski construction, you can already tell how rockered these boards actually are. I'll grab this regular Condor for comparison. Now, when I hold the Rockered Condor right on top of the regular Condor, you will see the early rise in both of these tips in both the front and the rear. Now, the Rockered Condors are a little bit flexier than the traditional Condors, so that's gonna allow your tips to stay up even higher when you're floating through powder, and look how flexy these things are. These Rockered Condors are like noodles or bird wings. They're super flexy, and I've only ridden these a few times because you really need deep powder if you're gonna be riding something like this. But when I have ridden them, they are super fun. Hopefully, I can get into some backcountry stuff here later in the season, and we'll be able to ride these things a little bit more. One more comparison between the cheap quality foam core snowblades versus ski boards. Again, here you will see you got way more width in the nose and even more in the tails. So, snowblades, ski boards, definitely not the same thing. It's a common misconception from a lot of people out there, and honestly, the sport kind of gets a bad rap. The thing is, especially if you're a skier, if you know the history of what ski boarding actually is or was, then you will know that twin tip skis and freestyle skiing as we know it today really wouldn't be a thing without ski boarding first paving the way. I wish the professional ski boarding circuit continued on, because as soon as that fell off, then companies who were making ski board like Canon and Line, they switched to traditional skis as we know them today. But there are still a few of us out there who are holding on to the sport. It's something that I love. It's been a part of my life for, man, the longest time, pretty much as long as I can remember. And I wouldn't have it any other way. I'm gonna be ski boarding, hopefully, until the day that I die. So hopefully you guys learned something from this, the difference between a high quality ski board and some junky Salomon snowblades. If you have any questions about the sport of ski boarding, please let me know in the comments down below. I'm gonna try to reply to pretty much everyone who leaves a comment. I've been in the sport for a long time. I have friends who have been in the sport for even longer, so we love to chat it up with you guys and let you know all about the sport. I would love to run into some of you guys out there on the mountains who are interested in the sport, because I have enough ski boards to sort of man a small army. So if you see me out on the hills somewhere in the country, stop me, say what's up. 9 times out of 10, I have an extra pair of boards, or even more, in the van, and I'd love to get more people into the sport. So that's going to be all for today. I have a lot of ski boarding content coming up here pretty soon as we head out into the Rocky Mountains in Colorado. In the meantime, you can check out this playlist right up here in the corner for all of your other ski boarding information. If you are new to this channel, consider clicking subscribe. I make new videos every single week. And as always, thank you for watching. I'll talk to you in the next one.